In the space of 100 days, around 800,000 people lost their lives in the Rwandan genocide. One man who experienced the terror of those 100 days is Murangwa Eugene.
Living in fear of death, knowing that you can be killed any second, it was a kind of feeling that it's not easy to describe.
At the time, Eric was an 18-year-old goalkeeper playing for Rayon Sports, one of Rwanda's top clubs.
The Rwandan society was basically broken. When we won the game, people forgot whatever differences that they had at the time.
A quarter of a century later, the former captain of Rwanda now uses football to bring people together, as we've been finding out.
Football field, in my view, it's another place where people can learn as much as what they learn in the classrooms.
But Eric says back in 1994, it was football that saved him.
So it was here that I witnessed the first person in the neighborhood being killed. My name is Eric Murangwa Eugene. I am a former international Rwandan football player, survivor of the 1994 genocide against the Tutsi. In our neighborhood, the roadblock was here. It had been instructed by the authorities that every neighborhood, every street had to have a roadblock. One of the neighbors, a man called Thief, came from that end, and he was escorted by two men who I didn't know. So they descended, crossed the road, walked towards where the motorcycles are parked. You know, I watched the first actions, then I realized what was happening, and then I walked away. And that place, from that day on, became pretty much a killing field.
The slaughter and the war have driven people onto the roads, desperately trying to find the few safe places.
Started was something that was planned and carried out by the government forces and the militia. But within a few weeks after it started, the ordinary people, they were encouraged to be part of the genocide machine. That allowed the genocide to be as efficient as it did, because you were chased by neighbors and friends, and in some cases, same family members. So there was no way to hide. This is the National Stadium, Amahoro. During the genocide against the Tutsi in 1994, quite a number of people fled into this place. I can remember how great that moment was. The stadium was full to its capacity. It was a very sensitive time where Rwanda was going through a very, very difficult period. The Rwandan society was basically broken. Hutus and Tutsis. But when we won the game, people forgot whatever differences that they had at the time, and they celebrated our win as one people. Football became a very important part of my survival. This hasn't changed that much. This is the house I was living in 25 years ago. Wow. It hasn't changed that much at all. Can feel the atmosphere, I can relive the memories of what happened. Around 1 p.m. local time, when a group of soldiers came into this house, and they were coming to kill us, screaming, shouting. I was lying down where this small table is. So the soldiers were going around the house, throwing things up and down, and calling us all sort of names, and it was very scary, very scary. I can still, you know, hear their screams right now. One of the things that they were throwing up and down happened to be a photo album. It caught the attention of one of the soldiers, and he asked me, who are the people in the photos? And I said that they are my teammates. And I could see that his face completely changed as soon as he realized who I was. So for the next 10 minutes, we were talking about football, really. Just a few minutes earlier, I genuinely feared for my life. Definitely, the photos saved my life. This is the place where I came to seek refuge 2 days after the genocide had started, and we are now about to go to my former teammate's house. And the name of Rayon Sport on his motorbike. He's a proper fan. For the next 2 weeks or so, my teammates, in particular Longe Munyurangabo, went out of their way to really help me out. There might be a message that's saying there is an incident, so we would run this way. So you would jump over and you fell on the other side. And then whenever the danger would cleared out, someone will give you a signal, and then you come back. Living in fear of death, knowing that you can be killed any second, it was a kind of a feeling that it's not easy to describe. Coming to this house, it was definitely the best decision I've ever made in my life, because it contributed to my survival. I needed help, I needed support. I needed someone to show that he or she cared for me, because my own state had completely abandoned me. This is the room that people were staying in. Each room had anything between 5 and 20 people. We had a handful of UN peacekeepers stationed outside. We survived by staying in and waiting every second to see what would happen. My younger brother, Irankunda Jean Paul, who was only 7 years old at the time, he was killed during the genocide. Aunties, uncles, and cousins and nieces were also victims. There was still issues from those who had carried the genocide, and they were still trying to finish what they could not finish during those 100 days. I was a bit scared of what might be out there. Though I had survived and the war had ended, I was not in a situation where I could truly feel safe. Think that I survived for a reason, and that reason is to try and use the experience of suffering to build a better and safe future of my community, my country, and the world at large. So the soldiers were going around the house, throwing things up and down. It was very scary. I can still, you know, hear their screams right now.
Eric told us how pictures of him playing football for Rayon Sport, one of Rwanda's top clubs, kept him alive.
Just a few minutes earlier, I genuinely feared for my life. Definitely, the photos saved my life.
Now, more than 25 years on, he's using football to heal the divide in his home country. We went with him to take a look.
We are at Togetherness Center. It's a place that brings people together, especially young people. So this is the man who made it happen. His name is Pastor Stephen. Hi, Stephen. We would really love to know a little bit more about yourself and how you came to bring this center together.
There was a lot of younger people who were grieving and suffering because of the consequences of the genocide. As a pastor, it was a very big challenge to come with religious message to people. But I knew that if I begin with sports, then that would be easier for the youth to listen to me. Nagira ngo mumbyire namwe nk'abantu baba sportive. So we wanted to use sports to encourage the community for peace building, for reconciliation. Each one would do, oh, I thought that maybe it's only me such a problem, but there is a lot of others who went through such a terrible situation.
The center is trying to build a proper football field that will be used as part of their long-term plan.
They don't think about being Hutu or Tutsi because they come here for having fun, playing football. My family was affected, yeah, but it's for one party of my father's family, yeah. One of them, they are Tutsi, others was Hutu, yeah. I don't like to talk about that.
We started with 9 children, and today we are 240, which is amazing.
They are my new family, because when I came together with them, I can be happy. I can join them and share the ideas. Always I'm happy when I'm with them.
Nothing's impossible!
South of Rwanda. So it's about 1 hour drive from Kigali. Sport fields, football field, in my view, it's another place where people can learn as much as what they learn in the classrooms. Groups that you can see behind me already going through different exercises that helps young people to understand the importance of using football as a tool for social impact. As you can see, there are girls and boys mixed together, playing together, learning together. This country is a country that has a very tragic past, a very sensitive history. To be able to communicate that history to the young generation, it's much easier to do it in this type of settings.
We just tell how they were before. They were like the Tutsi, Hutu, but now they are not. So we don't mention you are this, you are that. So we live like Rwandese, Rwandans, not the Hutu, not the Tutsi.
These games we play allow us to relax and encourage us to avoid conflicts and discrimination.
It helps me to better understand what happened and gives me motivation to stand against that mindset myself and towards others.
First of all, they love each other. One sees another as a friend. They sometimes visit each other, and as a parent, we are happy to be part of it because it reflects the unity and reconciliation between Rwandans.
The youth are part of a wider community. They come from families, they come from villages that have more adults than probably the youth. So it's important to also work with the adults. This generation has no idea of what happened 25 years ago, or they don't necessarily have a direct connection with it. It's their parents, it's their neighbors who have much more connection with us. One of them is Mr. Kamuhanda, who I played football with, Rao Kamuha. So this gentleman, I played football with him many, many years ago when he was part of second team of Rayon Sport. He has a very important story to share.
He stayed in my house for about 3 weeks, then I hid him in a crop field. People came hunting for him and he ran away. He was killed. I was interrogated and they were not convinced by what I told them, so I was sent to jail, first in Nyanza. But later, people came forward and confessed to the mother. I should not have let the child go. It hurts me in my heart.
I'm the one who brought Kamuhanda to this team, even though I knew his history. What made me bring him here is because I trusted him and his desire to reintegrate into society.
When I came back from prison, I was not at ease being around people. I was not able to look people straight in their eyes. It was a big problem for me, but because of sport, I have now learned to accept myself, and they accepted me. Someone who knows they committed genocide should confess and apologize, and they will be forgiven. This morning, I was at church, and a woman came with someone who killed her family. On top of that, she showed terrible machete scars all over her body. I have some kids playing here, and my daughter is quite good. I tell everyone how good sport is. I also tell them how I was welcomed by my teammates, as we share the same passion for sport.
Football, to me, is a powerful tool to really bring change to people, to influence people positively. And I use it today to make sure my children and the children of my friends and neighbors will understand the danger of division. It's a long and hard journey of changing the mindset of people. It's not something that you can finish in 5, 10, or even 20 years' time. It will be here for a long time, but I'm pleased on what has already achieved. Football saved my life.